Collin, does it feel like coming home?
It does. I'm staying at my parents' house on Saturday night. Every time I come back to LA, it's my favorite spot in the world. It's always going to be home for me, no matter where I live, no matter where I move to. And there's just that extra added touch, specialness when you're playing at home, when you're playing in the state of California for me. So hopefully put together four really good rounds out here and see what happens.
Talk a little bit about your familiarity with LACC and how the course is looking this week.
Yeah, I don't think I ever saw LACC until 2016 when I knew the Walker Cup was going to be out here. Obviously, I knew I had chances to make that team. We had some alumni out here that were members at LACC. So obviously playing the Walker Cup in 2017. We're doing a project with the SCGA, LACC, members at LACC, the USGA, this four youth project that is amazing, helping restore Maggie Hathaway, this nine-hole short course. So I've been able to come out here, see it a few times this year, but finally seeing it yesterday for the first time, completely different in a good way. You know, it still has the structure of what it is, but the rough being up, the course being, you know, playing a little firmer, being tournament conditions, it obviously plays a little different.
All right, we're going to open it up to questions. Jeff, right here on.
Collin, what's your coming back? What's your lasting memory from the Walker Cup, or maybe something that kind of puts a smile on your face, or something you recall about that week that always comes to mind?
Yeah, I think we got credited down for the first match. Me and Norman, we got credited, I think, for like 8-7, but I'm pretty sure we won the last hole, and I wanted 9-7. That entire week was amazing. I mean, it was a full long week of just us hanging out as boys and realizing that it's only 2 days. And that was the craziest thing, is it doesn't hit you until you play 2 days and you're done with the Walker Cup. But all the activities, all the dinners right before, we're having a great time. We're playing great golf courses. Those are some of the best times that you could ask for. You know, those team events when you're hanging out with those guys, aside from the golf course, you know, it's some of the best memories I've had. Obviously, really good memories here, playing well with the guys, you know, obviously a dominating win going on from there. So I have good memories, good shots out here, which is going to be nice to kind of go back on, hopefully, and hit some of those.
Right here to Brentley.
You're probably the only guy to have played 15 at 78 yards. I guess that was Saturday singles of the Walker Cup. What do you remember about the hole that short, and what are some challenges or some things that stand out, and how you play that hole?
I joined DJ and Gary yesterday for 16-18, and they asked me about it because yesterday I think it was like 120, and they played from that tee. I remember, like, you almost had to practice teeing up a 60-degree lob wedge like an inch off the ground, which you never do, and just trying to hit it perfect, because you had to hit it with height, you had to hit it with spin. It's only going to be that much more important this week if they do move it up. I'm sure they will. You have like a yard and a half to land it if you want to hit a good shot. If not, you got to play left and hopefully hit a good putt. It's frustrating because you can hit an okay shot and you not get rewarded at all. So especially out here, you can't land it in the rough. It's not going to bounce out. You've got to land it in the right spot. I just remember it was a very tough shot. I pulled it off, and I think I still had like 20 feet for birdie.
On your right to Gary.
Collin, is it possible that this golf course can be a complete examination and also be as difficult as any major championship venue you've seen?
Yeah. What's different is that a lot of the major championships I've been to, I've never played in I've never had a lot of history. I've never played there, right? Harding Park was one of the few ones. Pebble I had played before. But a course like this, when I've seen it for the Walker Cup, when I've seen it in practice rounds coming earlier this year, there's a sense of, I almost get desensitized to it being a major championship course, not in a bad way, but I think it helps me just knowing that I can go out and just play and play it how I've been used to. Yes, I'm going to change some lines out here. Tee boxes are going to be moved all over the place, but it helps. You know, sometimes when you show up to a major championship, you're so focused in on how everyone else is playing it, right? I think Augusta is a great example where we show up there every single year. You hear what guys need to do, but then you forget how to play it your own way. And I think when you play it as an amateur golfer, when you play it for fun, you learn courses and you learn it based on how you like to see courses, right? Fitting that shot shape, doing what you do best, and playing to your strengths. And I think when you start coming to major championships and you listen to other guys and how they're playing it, sometimes you get kind of clouded in your judgment on saying, maybe this is how I should play it. So it's been great to see it as a course at a major championship. Yes, I do think the scores are going to be, there's going to be a lot of variance to the scores. There are still birdie holes out here, no doubt about that. I mean, the par fives are very gettable. But you have to keep it in the fairway. I think we've all seen it this week. Just like a lot of U.S. Opens, you throw a ball in the rough. It's kind of hit or miss, roll the dice. Are we going to get a good lie? Are we going to get a bad lie? You know, it's going to be on us to hopefully find out certain spots. Can we get lucky in the rough? Is it a little thinner than some other places?
On your left, Anne.
Hi, Collin. With everything going on off the course, all the distractions, all the noise, how do you stay focused with your golf game this week?
I don't know. I've been pretty good about just taking myself out of everything that's going on. I mean, it is what it is. I can't control what's going to happen. None of us can, no matter what we write up or what we say. So, this was a major that I cared about when I was like in college, and I knew about, you know, LACC hosting a U.S. Open. I didn't know where my path was going to be. I didn't know if I was going to be on tour, if I was going to have to qualify for this. And right, 4 years. This is pretty much 4 years since I've turned pro. I didn't know where I was going to be, but this is the one that I wanted to make it, and the one I wanted to be at, just because it is home for me. So, this week means so much. It always will be. It'll always be really special. But that's just the added bonus and added fuel for me to just go out there and put everything I have, and not waste my energy on anything else.
We're going to take one from the WebEx. For those not here and who will be seeing LACC for the first time on TV, just a brief glimpse into what the course is like.
It's a big golf course. I mean, I think yesterday I played the front nine, played a few holes on the back, and I hit a lot of four and five irons into par fours. It's just, there's a drastic change of short holes to long holes to I think the par threes are some of the most challenging. I mean, yes, some of them are very long. I think the USGA is going to be great about moving tee boxes around to where, you know, we're not hitting five woods. I mean, I hit three wood into hole seven yesterday. So there's going to be that variance of what you need to do. But it's just it's a big boy golf course. I mean, it really is. You got to hit good shots, especially with how penal the rough is. You got to hit it in the fairways. It's what you want for a major championship.
On the left to Bill.
You went in contact with Tiger Woods since his surgery?
Not personally, no.
Since this event is in Southern California, do you think he's especially missed not being here?
Yeah, I think he's missed all over the place, but I think his presence in the game of golf is always known, right? I mean, he's impacted this game in ways that only some of us could dream of and some of us want to do in this game, and just impact the lives of many people. I think a lot of us here today in the field, and a lot of us even in this room, owe it a lot to Tiger, why we got involved in the game. I mean, maybe not the sole reason, but for me growing up, that's all I cared about. You know, like I it's been amazing to get to know, you know, guys like Rory and Jordan and JT and all these guys, but like I didn't care about them when I was growing up. You know, I didn't, you know, I really didn't. And you know, people ask me about the history of, you know, Rory winning this or Rory, you know, certain guys winning this, like I didn't really care. You know, I only cared about Tiger. So, yeah, I think he's always missed, but he's always going to impact this game in ways that we can't even describe, in ways that we don't even know. I think for him, it's just to be healthy at this point. I don't know. Who knows when we're going to see him or not. I don't think any of us take that for granted anymore. But it was amazing, at least for my first couple of years, getting to play with him a few times, getting some pairings with him. Like, that's the coolest thing you can dream of.
Front right.
Mentioned the challenges that the par threes present here. What's special about the 11th in particular, and can you kind of describe some of the challenges of that hole in particular?
Yeah, special, I wouldn't really use that word. I would just characterize it as long. It's just a long downhill par three. I mean, if I walk out of there with four threes this week and put it in the middle of the green, I'm going to be thrilled. You know, I think on that hole, you're not trying to hit it close to the hole. And there's a few holes out here where you're not trying to hit it close to any hole. Like you hit it in the middle of the green, you give yourself a 30-footer, walk out, very happy. Because you can't really get too aggressive to any of those pins. So that's where I think like hole 15 is a very special hole. There's a lot of character to hole 15 because you can move pins, you can move tees. It's a wedge shot. It could be a 9-iron, it could be an 8-iron, depending on wind. That's a special hole. 11 is just a long par three.
Over my shoulder to Bob.
Can you explain what happened at the Memorial and when were you able to get back to playing golf and anything lingering still?
It was weird. I've had I wouldn't say back problems, but you know, I've had a little back pain here and there, but nothing has been crazy, and it's not been because of golf, and this wasn't because of golf. This was just bad movement. So we were in the gym warming up, doing some reactive exercises. I went after it with my back, and it sucked because I felt like I was grinding for 3 days to put myself in contention. We figured some things out Saturday afternoon. That's when you're excited to wake up and you're like, man, we can put together a few birdies early on and you're right there tied for the lead. And who knows what could have happened, but it was very unfortunate. It sucked. It was a course that I loved. I took a few days off, got some rest, got some rehab, talked with my team. We got started hitting balls late last week, and we're swinging fine. There's no pain swinging right now, which is great. I might be teeing up kind of weirdly this week, so don't take too much into that. But it's just precautionary. Look, I think we do so much leaning with our back, bending over, that I've just built in bad movement patterns. And that for me, like, it's being able to just make sure I bend properly from the hip, rather than putting too much stress. So it's just gonna be precautionary with how I'm moving this week. But swing wise, there's no pain, which is great. I've hit out of rough, I've hit out of bunkers, no pain, nothing lingering, nothing anywhere else in the body either. So that's good. So yeah, we put together the team. It's been great. It was just terrible, terrible timing.
Right here on your left.
What are some of the things during the practice rounds specifically you guys are looking at in, on hole six? It seems like guys are spending a little bit extra time there compared to some of the other holes here on the course.
Yeah. Before this week, I hadn't talked to my caddy, and I thought I was going to lay up. He convinced me in like 2 minutes that we might be going for it. Look, I think there's going to be a lot of different strategies there. Some guys are going to feel comfortable going for it and taking what they got with any lie. And some guys are going to lay up knowing that they're going to have a wedge in their hand. There's a lot of different strategies. We're going to see a lot of different numbers, I think. I mean, you might see some eagles. You might see some doubles. You just don't know what you're going to get there. And that's what's so difficult. My caddy made a great correlation to Riv at 10. It's not quite that, but we don't really know. We don't have the history here. I mean, if I go and play Riviera and I play 10, even par, I'm happy. I'm not thrilled, but I'm not mad because I didn't give any shots away. I don't really know how it's going to play out this week. I think if I do have four pars, I think I'm going to be okay with that. But there are guys for sure that are going to be 300-400 par for the week, and they're going to play it different ways. I think one guy might go for it, one guy might lay up, and you're still going to have guys that are 400. But it's this week, I think it's taken away the big numbers. Big numbers can add up really quickly out here with back-to-back long holes, long par threes. You just got to really take advantage and be smart when you're trying to make those birdies.
Back right.
Colin, I'm curious, in the times you've played here, have you heard any strange stories or heard any strange noises near the area near the 14th tee?
I mean,
I'll leave it at that.
No, I haven't. Have you?
I have not yet.
Okay. I have not.
Right here.
After your tweet the morning of the merger, you've had a few days to, you know, to process it and talk to people. Can you share what your thoughts are at this point?
I don't know anything. So I'll talk about my four youth program or project that we're doing. It's this Maggie Hathaway project. It's amazing. It's in a community that is for underprivileged kids that don't have an opportunity to play. There's many great organizations coming on board with this. And it's something that means a lot to me. I think LA has a big divide. I mean, look, we get to play Riviera every year. We play LACC this year. There's a huge divide between private golf and public golf out here in Los Angeles. Not the case for everyone, but there is. There really is. And most people are playing public municipal golf courses. And the change of this golf course is going to be great. It's going to give opportunities, I think, that I've learned from golf that are able to just teach kids just the real world. You know, school teaches a lot of things, but the real world is you can learn a lot from golf. So that's my answer. No, I did not. It was just something that I was honored to be, you know, an honorary chairman of this project, and something that I wanted to give back to this community. I think I was curious how, you know, LA was going to accept the U.S. Open, right? To me, like, I play in these majors, and they're just normal to me at this point now, which is great. But it is a big deal for the city, and I think it is, and I think to leave an impact like that is pretty awesome.
Last two, Luke and then Adam.
Hey, Collin. You mentioned you were teeing the ball up slightly differently as, like, a precautionary thing. Are there any other precautionary changes you're making to, like, your practice or your, you know, your wind down, your range routine, anything like that?
No, same warm up, same routine, doing everything the same, just teeing it up weirdly.
how exactly? I haven't seen you tee it up yet this week. What's the technical?
I just pretty much squat down and tee it up, pretty much like that.
Adam,
a couple quick ones for you. How far away is this course from where you grew up?
No traffic on Sunday. It took us like 40-45 minutes. Okay.
And what was it that your caddy said that convinced you maybe you're going to go driver on six?
Well, we hit two irons off the tee, and I hit one in the rough, and I was never going to hit the green from the rough. But the whatever they call it, the barranca down below where the bunker is down there, it is very bad. I mean, you can get a very bad lie, but you can also get a lie that's like all right to where you can hack it out to the middle of the green. I mean, look, like I said, if I can make four pars there and maybe give myself one birdie shot inside 10 feet, I think I'll be all right for the week. I assume the greens are going to get a lot firmer throughout the week, especially if we start seeing some sun. The wedge shot, I mean, look, we're the best players in the world, and we can hit a 60-yard wedge shot, 70-yard. We can hit our numbers. But I'm just kind of trying to play like the odds where, okay, if I have a little chip shot, maybe I can just chip it out to 25 feet and get away with a four. So like, it's not set in stone yet. Maybe depending on certain pin locations, we move it around. But right now I'm kind of leaning towards going for it, which I definitely was not. I mean, I was probably set 90% I was going to lay up before we saw it yesterday.
You said you don't really know anything about the partnership that's been discussed. What is the one thing you'd most want to know?
That's hard because I think for a lot of different parties, there's a lot of different reasons of why it's happening, right? So we all want to know the why, and that's, I think, we're so interested in the why, right? For us, like, for me right now, it's just like, what's going to happen? I don't know. But like, we always want to know that why answer, like what's the purpose behind it? But I think there's so many different parties involved that there's too many answers to really put it into one underlying umbrella, right, of the why. Because I think what you've seen from the players versus what you've seen from maybe our commissioner versus the board versus Yasser versus Liv versus there's a lot of parties, right, involved. Everyone has had a kind of different answer and different, you know, reaction to all this. So the why is, yeah, I think that's going to be very opinionated, and I don't think we'll ever really get an answer. But we don't even know what's going to happen, so. Or maybe you do.
All right, Collin, thanks for your time. Good luck this week.
All right, thanks, guys.